chapter 7, verse 8. Preached on this chapter a lot through the years. I had a little list of things that God said there in this chapter that we were preached 7 years ago back to church. Look a little different slant on this today. Joshua chapter 7, verse 10. And the Lord said unto Joshua, get thee up. Get up. Joshua, by the way, is on his face. Joshua's bawling, he's squalling. I mean, he's in bad shape. We'll tell you why in a minute. But finally, God himself said to Joshua, get up. Wherefore liest thou upon thy face? Israel has sinned. They have also transgressed my covenant, which I commanded them. They have ever taken of the accursed thing, and have stolen, and dissembled also, and they put it even among their own stuff. Once again, kind of along the same vein I've been on the last two sermons I preached. If you'll notice there, God is addressing the whole bunch. Did you notice the pronouns there? God says Israel. He didn't say Achan has sinned. He says Israel has sinned.
That's right.
I'm going to show you that in a minute. They have stolen. They have taken the accursed thing. Put it among their own stuff. Therefore the children of Israel could not stand before their enemies, but turned their backs before their enemies. That's what's happening to us. Because they were accursed. Neither will I be with you anymore, except you destroy the accursed thing from among you. I'm going to tell you something, folks. That's a sobering few passages of scriptures right there. After the conquest of Jericho, after 40 years of wilderness wandering, and then finally, they get there to the river. They walk across on dry land. They march around Jericho. You remember? They did it for 7 days, then 7 times. Y'all know the story. Walls came down. And man, they went in, and it was a cakewalk in the park as they took the greatest city on the earth at that time. God did that. And man, they're high-fiving, and man, wasn't that great? And probably Brother Paul said a little bit, boy, didn't we do good? Don't you figure there was a little of that going on among the generals and some of the soldiers? Man, did we not whip them guys? I mean, did you see what we did? Not even once looking over and noticing that the walls were falling down. That's how they got in.
Yeah.
That's right. Stop. Do you remember the story? I'll tell you what, let's pray. I'll let you sit down. God's opportunity today. I pray that you'll help me today to speak with power, with authority, with humility. And I pray, dear God, this one thing, that you talk to people on the inside while I talk on the outside, and we'll have us a servant tonight. You'll bless. God, there'll be lives changed. There'll be people encouraged. There'll be sin confessed. There'll be lives changed. So that's why we ask you to do it, because we can't do it in our own strength and our own abilities. God, we really have learned that. So help us tonight. Anoint us. Give us unction from on high. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may say it. God got them all together, told Joshua what to say. He said, I'm going to give you this city. I'm going to cause the walls to fall, and just because you're being obedient to me. Not because of anything you've done, but simply because you've been obedient to me. You're my people. I love you. Well, what's best for you? And you're being obedient. You're walking in obedience. Therefore, the walls are going to fall. You're going to go in. You're going to take the city. The end. But he said, once you get in there and they start falling before you, he said, here's this one thing I require. He said, the spoils belong to me.
Right.
Now, did God need the stuff?
No.
Did God need the clothes or the gold or the silver? No, you didn't need any of that stuff.
Right.
But God was teaching the people there, first of all, who's going to obey me in the face of temptation. I mean, hey, in the middle of a revival meeting when the Holy Ghost is just, every altars are full and people are slobbering, bawling, and throwing babies. I mean, hey, I'm good, God. I mean, but God said, I want to see what you do. You know, when the fight's over and the temptation comes, the victory's already come, and now you're walking through the city looking at the fallen city and you're seeing all the stuff there. Hey, he said, leave it alone. Don't touch it. Don't bring it into your house. The spoil belongs to me. But there's one guy, Achan, and this is what this is about. Achan went and saw some stuff that he wanted. And you know what? That's just the bottom line. He wanted it. By the way, that's where we always get in trouble.
Right.
When we start doing what we want versus what God wants.
Right.
Achan said, I want it. I want the clothes. Put clothes in, you'll hit him. I want the money. And he hid there in his tent. You know, dug a hole. He hid all this stuff under his tent. Said, okay, nobody saw me. I was real discreet about it. I deleted my history. Nobody saw. Everything's cool. Forgot one thing. Preached last year in that sermon. He forgot one thing. God was watching. Just like he's watching you. He saw every step that Achan took. But that's not what I'm preaching about now. God watching. But then they had a battle now. The next battle was a little old city over there called Ai. Y'all all know the story. I'm just reiterating. They went up there to this next little town, this little hamlet down there that wasn't much. And they said, you know what? We're such a great army. And after what we've done to Jericho, let's don't even take the whole army over there. Let's take 3,000 guys and go over there, whip Ai, win the victory, and then we can once again gather around the campfire and tell each other how great we are. So they went over to Ai, and guess what? This little old city rose up and whipped their britches good. 36 men died at Ai. 36 of God's people died. You with me so far? That's a sad picture of the church that we'll talk about. Joshua is discouraged about it. Man, 36 men have died. 36 families are affected. I mean, it's a bad day. People are wailing and wallowing and ashes on their head. I mean, good night. How could this happen? How could the great nation of Israel, how could the great church of God in the wilderness, how could this, so could God's people, how in the world could we have Jericho one day and Ai the next? How in the world? They're looking at, how could this happen? We're the greatest army on the face of the earth.
Right.
Joshua is right in the middle of that mix. Joshua's discouraged. Mourners are wailing. God says, Joshua, get up. There's sin in the camp. And he said, Joshua, here's the deal. It's either Achan or me. It's either Achan or me. That's what the title of my message is tonight. Achan or me. Finally, the lot fell on Achan. After God spoke to Joshua, told him what to do, you can read all that later. God said, get up, and then he began to tell him there's sin in the camp. He's taking the cursed thing, and they drew lots, and guess what? The lot fell on Achan, and then God said, I want you to take him and his family, and even his animals, take him outside and stone him to death, because the people need to see when you disobey me that it don't just affect you, it affects your family, and it also affects the whole church.
Right.
Yeah.
And Brother Danny, I believe God has shown me that in recent days. That when God is not blessing, when the altars aren't full, when people are not being saved, when we have dry eyes and empty pews, that there's something desperately wrong. And I believe with all of my heart that part of the reason can always be that there's sin in the camp, and God says that I'm not going to bless that. He said that, notice, there's only one guy that did it, but notice how God speaks in the plural. God says they, ye, they, we. I mean, God says, hey, the whole group, the whole church, is affected. Well, preacher, what I did, I didn't think it affected. Yet, that's the trouble. You thought. Well, you were out there committing adultery or fornication or on the internet site. You didn't think about it affecting the Wasco church. You didn't think about it affecting Norwalk. You didn't think about it affecting Cornerstone when you're out here sinning against God. But God says, hey, it's either A or B. God says, I'm not going to put up with it. God said, listen, God tells us, Brother Daniel, he says, I've given you the ability to have spiritual discernment to know when something's wrong. And that's what he was jumping on Joshua about. Get up! What are you doing laying on your face, bawling, squalling, slobbering? He said, get up! You've got sin in your camp. He said, when you deal with your sin, he said, then I'll bless you. Now, that's not very popular in this day and age. But it's the truth of God's word. Okay. I had a good thought about how we're losing men. God says, remember, I looked for a man among them and I couldn't find one. We're losing men to gold. Brother Danny, you losing men to they can't come to church because their work won't let them. So we're losing men to gold. The very job that God gave you,
that's right,
yeah,
is the very job you let, you'll keep you from being what y'all be forgotten. So, we're losing men to gold. We're losing men to glamour. We're losing men. I mean, here's the little four-point outline of you. Some of you preachers was wanting. We're losing men to gold. We're losing men to glamour. We're losing men to gusto, the pleasure, and the fun of this world. And we're losing men to girls. Just another G there. And I've told you about the pornography problem in America that's in the church. And it's real, and we see it's more real. Brother Danny, just since I've been with you, I've had to set two key men down. Two key men at Cornerstone Ministry. Two key men. And because I've been recorded, I can't go into all what I need to go into. But understand this. I can't help you as much as I need to. But I've had to set them down because of internet pornography. Because of the lust of the flesh. I got about 4 points I want to talk to you about tonight. Achan or me? Why is my life not being blessed? Why is my church not what it ought to be? Why is my family having all this difficulty? Why, God, why? Hey, I mean, he's down in his face saying, oh, God, oh, God, oh, God, oh, God. And God, I mean, God's saying somebody tonight in this building, get up. There's some things that need to be took care of. Okay, let's go. We decided to have our possessions over his presence. That's a fact, Jack. We have decided that. We decided that we're going to have our possessions over his presence. God says it's either your things or me. I mean, see, there's nothing wrong with things. Unless those things become more important than his presence. Whether it be clothes or a nice house or money, etc. I mean, and by the way, whether it be views or opinions or a desire to have my own way, God spoke to my heart in that arena. That understand that God says it's either those things that you're holding on to or me. Make a choice. In the sense, in the church, it doesn't matter if we have metal or brick or whether we have carpet or tile floors. Or, you know, what really matters in our churches is if God shows up.
Amen.
The most important thing is God's presence. If God's presence is there. Now, does he say where two or three are gathered together, I'll be with them? No, he doesn't say that. He says when they're gathered together in my name, then I'll be in the midst of them. It's not what he's saying. It's not our way. It's his way. So we decided to have our possessions over his presence. Brother Danny, I remember the first time that any preacher ever told me about the Wasco church years ago. A guy had brought some kids out here and they sang for him. And he came back through Tulsa. He said, "Man, alive, I found a church out in California." He said, "A church that's our flavor. A church that has standards." He said, "And their music's lively. And they've got," he said, "and they're describing your storefront building there, that movie theater." And said, "You know what? They have power. They have the altars full." And he was bragging about the Wasco church. And I know that's been said about Cornerstone. But I wonder what's being said today. Exodus chapter 3, verse 2. It said, "The angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire," talking about Moses, "and the bush was not consumed." Ordinary day, thousands of bushes out there in the wilderness. But what do you think separated this bush from all the other hundreds of thousands of bushes in the wilderness? God got in. Yeah. God got in the bush. That was the only difference between that bush and every other bush in the wilderness. God got on the bush. God got in. Folks, okay, you show me a choir. You find me a choir that warms hearts. And you feel the anointing of God. Let me tell you, when you have somebody like that up singing, it blesses your soul. Hey, you have me a choir that does that. You know what the difference between that choir and another choir is? God got in. That's the difference. I'll show you after church online. You've got to listen to remind me. I was at somebody, Kevin Collins, at my church, and he said, "Watch this." We was in the pickup truck. He said, "Watch this." He scrolled up on YouTube this choir, Wesleyan Choir. Kids have their hair up in buns, long dresses, no makeup. Big choir. And this at this convention center. And this choir got up and sang. I'm watching and saying, "Good now, what's the big deal here? I mean, good night. Why does he want me to watch this?" And I watched this choir, and somebody on their phone probably recording it. But this choir began to sing a song, "I Know He Heard My Prayer," that old song about "I Know He Heard My Prayer. Oh, Satan told me that he wouldn't hear it, but I know the praise God it isn't true. He thrills me through and through. I know the Savior heard my earnest prayer." And I guarantee it's that choir. By the way, they weren't the most talented choir I've ever heard in my life. Brooklyn Tabernacle Choir is a whole lot better. I mean, hey, even the Mormon Tabernacle Choir had better singers. But I'm telling you this, you know what the difference? I sit there and I watch that. All of a sudden, people begin to get up and shout glory. And all of a sudden, these staid, holiness people begin. I mean, they're not Pentecostal. And they begin they got up. They didn't know what to do with themselves. Glory, hallelujah. This one old man who looked like he ought to be in the hospital got up and started praising God. Glory, hallelujah. They started leaving the choir and just jumping and hollering, praising God. And you know what I watched that? I watched that thing for about 10 minutes. They just kept on singing and I kept on praising. And here I was, before I knew it, I had my little Free Will Baptist hand up in the air. There in the truck said, "Bless God. God is in that choir." Amen. That's what made the difference. God got in it. You find me that special singers that does something to you. It's not their ability or their talent. God got in it. God showed up. You get me a Sunday school class that's growing, that's meeting the needs of the people in that class. And I'll show you a Sunday school class that God got in, just like he got in the book. You show me a youth group that has wholly separated kids living for God, that have a passion for soul winning, and they're alive and they're vibrant. You know what the difference between that youth group and some of these rock and roll mess is? It's because God got in that youth group. The presence of God. You show me a deacon that loves the Lord, that's loyal to his pastor, that's a soul winner, that's a shepherd, and does what the Word of God tells about service, and he's got this anointing. And listen, you know what difference in that deacon and another deacon is? God got on.
That's good.
traded that off for our way. We've traded our possessions for his presence. You show me a pulpit that's ablaze. You show a pulpit that's anointed. God got on it. God, give us some red hot pulpits. Folks, we can't do without God's presence. And if you hadn't figured that out yet, I don't know what we're doing.
That's right.
We cannot do without God's presence. And by the way, you can't lead your home, Daddy, without God's presence. Mama, you can't be the godly mother that you ought to be without God's presence. Or grandma, or grandpa, or pastor, or whatever that you're involved. You can't have the business that you ought to have if God don't get in that business. Then the reason why God blesses your air conditioning service and your business is all good. You know why? Because God wants to use you to be a blessing to win people to Christ. See, everything we do as church members, as children of God, everything ought to be focused back on the work of God. That's why I've got health. That's why I've got breath in my lungs. It's so I can be used of God. If I've got a good job, I can pay my tithes. Give God the glory for giving me the job. And then I can further the cause of Jesus and let the Holy Spirit do his work in my life, in my church, in my business, in my home, in my marriage.
Amen.
Good.
But we've traded that off. See, it's not beautiful buildings. It's not even good singing. It's not even good preaching. Or programs. It's God's presence. It's God's presence. The greatest compliment I ever got as a pastor. I've been introduced in a lot of different ways. But the greatest compliment that this old boy ever got was from a lost, destitute, I'm talking about no-count sinner man. A man that had been on the prayer list of every church in North Tulsa for years, a mean man, a wicked man, bad husband, bad father, bad everything. But one day, his wife got him to come to our church. We was over there, not on the 66 property, we was on the 63rd Union property over in that first building we had. I'm talking about, it was dilapidated, it was run down. We couldn't get insurance on the building because the building was so dilapidated. No insurance company would cover us. That's how bad the building was. It kind of rained. We had a fountain in the foyer, but it was one of them reverse fountains where it was coming down. I'm literally just flooding the floor every time it rained. Everything was in disarray. Do you know what happened back in 1986? God got in that place. I never will forget it. I never will remember seeing Mr. Wilson come in the door back there. And I saw him walk in and I said, good night. The town drunk had been saved 2 weeks before that. And now he's in church. His whole family's saved, sitting there on the second row. But in walks Mr. Wilson. He's kin to a lot of people there. And I remember one of the guys looked around. He did this. He did that. Never forget it. He couldn't believe Mr. Wilson came in. We had a good service that day. The church already started growing. We give them a taste of something. Several got saved. Offers was full. God's blessing. And he walked out and he didn't get saved. The next night, Monday night, I was on his doorstep. Now, he'd been noted. I'd already been told how that he took this. There'd been a preacher that preceded me that visited his house one time, and he literally threw him through the screen door. Mm-hmm. Now, I've had beer thrown at me through a screen door, but I never had anybody try to throw me through a screen door. But this guy did that to a preacher, threw him through a screen door and told him to get out and never come back. So I got the great privilege of getting to go see this guy. I went in, started talking to him, got a nice place here, I said, hey, we sure are glad you came to church yesterday, Mr. Wilson. Appreciate you being with us. He started shaking like that. He said, preacher, I couldn't sleep all night. He's shaking like that. He said, preacher, he said, I walked through the door of that church, and he said, my hair stood up on end. He said, I started having them doodads going up and down my, that's where I got the term from a sinner man. A sinner man. said, I started getting these doodads on my back and my hair standing. He said, God was in that place.
Amen.
He got saved that night, that Monday night right there in his living room. He was glad I came because he was so afraid. He went home scared, said he didn't sleep a wink that night because when he walked in the door, he said, God was in that place. I wonder if they're saying that about our churches. If we aren't having enough people in the altar, God isn't in it. And we need to start looking and saying, what's the deal? I remember one time at Lawton that this Muslim guy got saved. That's before anybody ever heard of a Muslim. We're talking about back in the 70s. This Muslim guy, he was a drill sergeant in the Muslim faith, whatever that was. He came to our church. He stood on the back row. He stood up, had the garb on, even had the hat on, you know, the African type Muslim hat. Had the garb, had all, I don't know what all the stuff symbolized. But he came back, and as he stood there and during Sunday school, he stood just like this, against the back wall, just like this, no expression. Sunday school teacher, little old young guy, just out of Bible college, and he was scared. I mean, it rattled him. This guy is standing. This guy's 6'4". I mean, he's a big old guy. He's a black guy. He's a bad guy. He's a tough guy. And then I got to preach my sermon. I knew who he was. I'm the one that invited him on the bus route. Get the altar call. Guess what? He's the first one on the altar to get saved. He said, What are you saying? I'm saying God was there.
Amen.
It wasn't the singing. Our singing wasn't no count. It wasn't the preaching. The preaching wasn't on him. It wasn't the talent. We didn't have any. We baptized 680 people in a 5-year period there. And there wasn't no good music. We didn't have, the guy that played the piano at that church, that mission church, the guy that played the piano, he was a 70-some-year-old man. And have you ever sung Amazing Grace to the tune of At the Cross? He only knew two songs, and he played those two songs, and we just fit the words into those two songs. You think you got it bad with your computer stuff? Every song, A Victory in Jesus, to the tune, you know, I mean, every song we had to sing in those two tunes. It was pitiful. But God bless, and I've got people that contact me every year. People that got saved back in that day from all over the world that called me and said, we're still serving God. We went to that church and God was in that place. And God moved on our heart. I mean, it was a great deal. But see, we've got all wrapped in money. We've got all wrapped up in retirement and houses. Even we preachers. And I mean, I went to the state meeting of Oklahoma and the whole deal was on retirement. A state meeting. God called me to preach. It's our possessions for his presence. Did you get that point? And I'll go on to the next. I've only got 18 tonight. Oh. Somebody fainted back there. It happened in the book of Acts, you know. Paul got in a big way preaching. One guy fell asleep and fell. Anyway. Number two, we've traded our prominence over his power. We've traded our prominence over his power. Dignity and style replace deity and strength. That's a great statement that you just missed. Dignity and style have replaced deity and strength. We started getting clergy and we stopped getting prophets. The Free Will Baptist these days is fastly becoming a non-profit organization. Did y'all hear that? Free Will Baptists are starting to be a non-profit organization. And I'm not talking about a 501c. There's not very many prophets these days in the pulpits of Free Will Baptist pulpits. When we stop getting reverence, we stop getting revival. Acts 3:6, I want you to see this. Acts 3:6. Then Peter said, here they are, Pentecost has come. The Holy Ghost came down in power. He said, you're going to receive power, and they did, bless God. They received power. So here they are going to fulfill the Great Commission. And guess what? There's this guy there at the gate called Beautiful. He needs help. He's begging for money. Remember that? Peter said, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, I give thee in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." Vance Havner said, "No longer can we say, silver and gold have we none, but no longer can we say, in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk." Mm-hmm. Now we have the silver and gold, but no power. The lame need the power now more than they need the silver and the gold. The beggar wanted money, but he got change in his life. Peter and John were unlearned and ignorant men, but when folks heard them, it's like they marveled at their knowledge that they had been with Jesus.
That's right.
Acts chapter 4:13 says, "And when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived they were unlearned and ignorant men, they marveled and they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus." Is that what they say about you? Hey, what's going on? When y'all go on visitation and you knock on somebody's door, when you go back down the street and they walk in their living room with that pamphlet in their hand, is that what they're saying about you? You know what? Those people have been with Jesus. Is that an unreasonable thing I'm saying? You know what? I don't know if I'm ever going to go to that church or not. I don't know if I like them or not. I've heard the preacher down there is pretty radical. I don't know. I don't know if I'm going to go. But you know what? Those people have been with Jesus because they had the power of God in their life. We've traded our prominence over His power. You know what we've happened? What we've had happen in our movement, that Brother Danny, a guy fails in church. Fails. He's a flop. He goes back to school and gets a master's degree. Then he gets a doctorate. He gets a DD. The DD stands for didn't do it. And then he starts teaching in Bible college up before young preachers telling them how to be a flop. The power.
Amen.
We've got to have the power in our homes, in our lives, in our churches. Do the people that at your work, do they say, you know what, that guy has been with Jesus? Do they say that about you? Most of our churches want a little pulpit here, in the pulpit, to preach a little sermonette, stay in the kitchenette, smoke cigarettes, what Leonard Ravenhill said. And God says, I tell you what I'll do, I just won't show up. God says, I don't want nothing to do with an old, dead church. You know what? I like it when the power comes. Hey, don't you? Don't you like when the power comes in the singing, in the preaching, when the juice starts coming out of your eyeballs? Hey, don't you love it when that happens? But we've traded our prominence over His power. Fire, the fire of God. Jeremiah says, I'm just going to quit. He said, I'm tired of these people. I'm tired of this whole deal. I'm tired of this prophet business. I'm just going to quit. This guy had a lot of trouble too. But you know what? He couldn't quit. He said, because there was the fire. There was a fire burning in my bones.
Yeah.
And I couldn't stay. Folks, when we preach, we need the fire on. When we sing, are you singers, listen to me, you need the fire on it. More than you need to be worried about hitting the note, you need to be worried about the fire of God being on that song. When we pray, we need the fire of God. Anybody remember Uncle Buddy Robinson? That was an old Nazarene preacher. You remember that name? He couldn't talk point. He had something wrong with you. Remember, said he loved boy, he couldn't talk point. People would ask him, it's so funny, I've heard it on tape. What are you going to preach? They called him Uncle Buddy. They'd say, what are you going to preach about today, Uncle Buddy? And he'd say, Jesus! Couldn't even say Jesus plain. He'd say, Jesus! And you can feel your hair stand on the back of your neck. 40 years after he'd said it on a cassette tape. Remember the sermon I heard him preach, the only one I ever heard it. Hey, you know what we need to take down on the farm, I said, he said, we had us some mules. And you know what, they've done them mules, they didn't want to go. This guy preached before thousands, crowds of thousands. Uneducated. Couldn't talk plain. He said, we had these mules, that whole way of farm, I said, now, he said, the one, when sometimes them mules, they won't go. He said, the way we get them mules to go, he said, yeah, there'll be some grass over there. In the field, I put that grass together, I give me a mash, and I like that mash on my wishing, and I like that grass I got out of the pasture. He said, after that grass got the burner real good, he said, I put it in that mule's belly. He said, you know what? The fire will make him go.
I remember watching that. Standing there, tears streaming down my cheek. Hair standing on my neck with no uneducated guy couldn't talk plain telling a mule story. He said, the fire will make him go. And then him portraying that, say, we got to have God's fire on our life.
Yeah, that's right.
Your prominence or his power. God says it's either Achan or me. Well, we've traded people over his promises. But then I did a little deal the other day on our church finances. We run about half what we run in our heyday. But we have, our budget is higher than it was in our heyday by quite a bit. And if I was a backslidden, I've heard preachers stand around and say, you know what? Church ain't doing very good. We got lots of money. You know, and they'd say, well, they didn't want to talk about souls or baptism, about things happening in the service. They want to talk about money. And you know what? Our budget right now is 34% higher than it was when we had twice as many people.
Amen.
We can't say silver and gold have we done anymore. We also are not saying, arise, take up thy bed and walk, as we've already said. Go with me to 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. I'll give you a very familiar verse. God says, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and I will heal their land. God says, I promise. Are you listening to me, people? God says, I promise. He said, you do four things, and I'll do three things. I'll do three big things. You humble yourself, you pray, you seek my face, and you turn from your wicked ways. He said, and I'll do three things. He said, I will hear from heaven. Don't we need God to hear from heaven? He said, I will forgive your sin. Don't we need our sin forgiven? God says, I will heal your land. Don't we need our land healed? God has made some promises. God says, I'll never leave you, forsake you. God says, I'll supply your needs according to my riches and glory by Christ Jesus. God says, you live for me, I'll take you to heaven. We've traded people for promises. See, my church wasn't built at Cornerstone on rich folk. It was built on just people. People in the highways and hedges. People that I've literally had to take my clothes off outside my house and throw them out in the yard and burn them the next day. I've been into places where in North Tulsa, I'm talking about the ghetto of Tulsa, where the roaches would literally crawl up your legs. You look around and the walls are black with roaches. Some of you say, well, them people are just not going to make heaven if I got to go in there. I'll sit there. But I guarantee I knew the Romans road quick. Never forget a man named Lloyd. Him and his wife got saved. There's a black family. That's the place I was talking about. I mean, roaches. When I got all the way home, roaches were calling. I was knocking roaches off of me. And I got started going to the house. I said, I ain't getting
literally, I'm not even exaggerating here. I'm telling you, there was roaches all over me. There's in my hair. So I take my coat off and my shirt off, my tie off, and I mean, I look down the highway and make sure no one is down there that do that in my hair. I mean, I take my britches off and I throw the clothes out in the yard and I go in the house and get in the shower and use me some Clorox. But old Lloyd came to church. He got saved. His wife and his four kids that lived in that squatter. He came to church, and that day we had the mayor of Tulsa in our church. Our people, they knew the mayor. We also had a senator there, the United States senator was there. We had two or three state senators there. I mean, it was a big, they had the fire chief there, the police chief there. I mean, it was a friend day. All these guys came as my guests. We had the lieutenant governor there. Had a letter from the governor, condolences why he was. We even tried to get the president there. But understand, when it comes to feeding time, my people were acting like a bunch of idiots trying to, you know, make sure the mayor and all the, I mean, they were putting in the front of the line. And I noticed, so Lloyd and his family, they were way back at the back. Wasn't nobody paying no attention to them. I went up and I put my arm around Lloyd, knowing full well what I was going to have to do before I went in the house. But I brought him up there right beside the mayor of Tulsa. I got him some food, his kids' food, and I went and I set him down right there by the mayor. I said, "Mr. Mayor, this is Lloyd." You know, I said, this mayor I didn't like because he's a Democrat. I said, his vote's just as good as mine.
Amen.
And that Sunday night, I read my people up one died, seven the other, because they showed preference. And the book of James says, don't you dare.
Amen.
That's right. Don't you do that. I told my people just the other night, my church wasn't built on rich folk. I've got one man right now that gives as much as what my entire budget used to be. One guy that gives as much as my entire. Our first budget was $3,200 a month. I got one guy in my church that gives over $100,000 a year. Every year. I've got several that give $50,000 a year. You say, well, what are you saying? Listen, let me finish. My church wasn't built on rich folks.
Yeah.
God's no respecter of persons.
That's right.
And I told my church just a few weeks ago, I said, you know what we need? We just have this lady coming on the bus. Her name was Big Mary. Big old, heavy set woman. I'm telling you, big woman. Kind of reminds you of Paul. That kind of looked like Paul. She's a black woman and just big old. Fat woman. And Big Mary, that's what everybody called her, Big Mary. What's your name, Big Mary? Big Mary come to church and take two or three seats for her to sit down. And by the way, she'd come in and she wanted to sit there. I mean, she just kind of scooch people over. Big Mary. Big Mary got saved, though. Her kids got saved. She rode the bus every Sunday. And if any of the kids got out of line, they had to deal with Big Mary. Told my church, Big Mary moved out of town. We had this other kid named Brian. Had a sister. Both of them were edgily slow. Both of them were like, you know, were drug babies. And Brian was very, 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 he couldn't hardly function. Brian would always come up with some of the more proper women in our church. He'd always just make a beeline for them. He said, I want a hug. And he'd just go in and, you know, slobber on them and just, you know, grab them and just, hey, I want a hug. Could you give me a hug? Have a hug. And boy, people got tired of Brian and wanted to have a hug. Finally, one day, the caregiver that was bringing Brian to our church said, I'm not going to bring Brian to church anymore. And I said, why? He says, because your people don't really want people like Brian here. my church just not long ago, and I said, you know what, we need some more Big Marys, and we need some more Brians in our church.
Yeah. Right.
But we've traded some things. You know what I'm afraid's happened? God says, okay, you made this deal, I ain't gonna show up.
Yeah.
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 I just won't show up. You won't do this deal? You want to trade people over promises? I mean, go ahead, but I ain't part of this deal.
That's right.
And that's happened in your families. It's happened in your homes. Truth of the matter is, some of you people in this room, you're living pretty high on the hog right now. The truth of the matter is, you might have been better with less. Yeah. Amen, Walls.
That's right.
Because, see, when you didn't have much, you knew you had to have God sometimes for your next meal. But now you don't need nothing. You're rich and increased with goods.
That's right.
You got a good job. And you got money in the bank. And you live in a nice house. God says, okay. We need some bus kids that'll dirty up our walls.
That's right.
We bring them homeless people in. I've lost people. I've lost prominent people that them homeless guys come into our church and they'll sit down there. I mean, you can smell them before they get there. That's a fact. You can smell them. I mean, they're dirty. They're drunk. You can smell weed. I mean, you know what? I used to have a whole drawer full of weed and stuff that took off, you know, took off these homeless guys. I sold it cheap. You know? Give it to missions. No, come on, come on. Y'all laugh. I was in Dickie Board meeting one time. This woman called. She says, Brother Gertie said, you got to come over. She said, Wayne's going crazy again, Wayne Gertie. Wayne's gone nuts and said, we're scared. Could you come over? Now, you always love it when you want to get in the right middle of a situation like that. I went over there. You can hear Wayne hollering, cussing, throwing things. I went in there and I opened the door and I said, what's going on here? Wayne was lost as a goose, you know. I told Wayne about Jesus. About 10 minutes later, he kneels down at his coffee table and gets right with God. Yeah, I mean, ask Jesus coming into his heart. I mean, this guy been in the penitentiary. This guy, I mean, he's bad to the bone. Wayne Gertie. But he got saved that night. Well, then I said, okay, now y'all okay? Yeah, everything's cool, man. I got a meeting. I got to go back to the Dickie Moore meeting. He said, wait a minute, Richard, before you go. He went in his refrigerator. It's full of whiskey and beer. He got a black trash bag. Started dumping that stuff in that trash bag. And he said, here, Bridge, I want you to have this. I don't need it no more. He went, never forget. He walked into the couch in the living room, puts the couch up like this. Puts the couch against the wall with one hand, and he's got a full brick of marijuana. I know you don't know what that is, but he had a brick, man. I'm talking about it. It wasn't three-finger lid. It was a brick. My mouth watered. No, never. I'm sorry, sister, man. I can't help it. He says, here, preacher, I want you to have this. He puts that in the bag. He goes back to the bedroom, brings his shoebox. He's got cocaine in little bags in the shoebox. He's got paraphernalia. He's got, you know, seed pipes. He's got all that. Here, preacher, I don't need this no more. Here, take this. So here I've got several $1,000 worth of weed. I've got cocaine. I've got whiskey. I've got beer. I mean, I've got a sack full. I mean, I'm not sack full. I'm going out of there. I go back to the Dickie Moore meeting. I'm carrying that black trash bag, and I dump it out on the table. I said, guys, we're going to have a meeting tonight. That really did happen. We didn't have any fussing that night. Church looks a lot different now than it did back when Cornerstone was Cornerstone, though. Let me close this. We've traded traded our peace over his purpose. Luke 19:10 says, "For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost." God's purpose. I'm so sick of hearing about this purpose, this purpose. God explains what his purpose is.
That's right. Yes.
That's right.
God's purpose is getting people saved. That's what it's all about. Mm-hmm.
Amen.
We've traded our peace and our comfort for his purpose. What we need to do, and I challenge some of you tonight to do here in a few minutes, I want you to get out of the middle of the road.
Yeah.
There's some of you people in this building right now that you are living your life right in the middle of the road. You know what? There's nothing in the middle of the road but dead skunks, chickens, and yellow streaks.
That's good, that's good.
Yeah, I thought so too. Dead skunks, chickens, and yellow streaks. That's all you'll find in the middle of the road. When we have no bus kids, no food bank, no homeless ministries, no ministries that are reaching the needy people, then what we've done is we've traded our peace, we've traded our peace for his purpose. That means I'd rather be comfortable than to be fulfilling God's purpose.
Right? Yeah.
I mean, good night. I'd rather watch a ball game on Saturday than go to Saturday visitation. Mm-hmm. I'd rather go to the lake. I want my peace. I want my comfort over God's purpose. God says, okay, you've got a free will. Mm-hmm.
That's
a good thing. Aren't you glad you got a free will? Mm-hmm. But at the same time, that can be a bad thing. Mm-hmm. God says, you know what? I'll let you do that. Go on. Comfortable. But I ain't going to show up.
Sorry.
God says, I'm out. And you're getting ready to have some caskets. 36 caskets lined up.
Here.
Over one guy in his sin. Is that right or wrong? We got to get back to the horse that run us. Our purpose is to reach people. We need saved men. We need scriptural men, separated men, soldier men, spirit-filled men, soul-winning men. But we've traded some things. Presence, power, promises, purpose. We've traded. We got to get back to God. It's either Achan or me. I'll tell you what, look up here and listen at me. Achan or me, God says. Or we're going to lose this battle.
Yeah.
God says, I just won't show up. And when I don't show up, death is what happens.
Yeah.
Hurt. And I'm asking, who here wants to be responsible for your church being under judgment? God said they. Only one did it, but yet God looked the whole church. I didn't make this up.
Yeah.
God said you have taken of the accursed thing. God says there's sin in the camp. And I'm talking to somebody right now, gun barrel straight. Your sin may be the very reason why that the church isn't doing what it ought to be doing. You say, we got a good church. I know you do. You got a good preacher. He's a good man. Understand, I know that. But I tell you what, one person that's making these trades can affect the whole Wasco church. It can affect the Norwalk church. It can affect whatever church is represented here today, the Cornerstone Church. One guy, one teenager in the back seat of a car can affect the whole church.
That's right.
He said, I don't believe that. Neither did they.
Yeah, that's right.
But there's 36 graves out there that begs to differ.
That's right.
There's 36 witnesses, probably a bunch of kids. I know of at least one daddy and one daddy-in-law that we see in Scripture, if you want to research it, that have just got through stoning their own family to death.
Yep.
That's right.
they would beg to differ. That God's serious about this stuff. You want to be responsible? Do you? Do you want to be responsible for people dying? Do you want to be responsible for people splitting hell wide? Well, everybody's got to give account for their own self. I understand that. They've got the free will to make the decision. But understand this, these, we still got 36 dead bodies here. Because one man decided he would do what he wanted to do, what appeased his flesh. I'm going to do what feels good to me. I'm going to make the decisions that I want to make. It really doesn't matter what God wants or what God says. I'm going to do this. And the whole church paid the price. Yeah. It's either Achan or me. That's what God says to you right now. What is your Achan's wedge right now? Your love for porn? Your love for premarital sex? What is your Achan's wedge? Your desire to do your own thing? I mean, to have your iPhones and your computer mess and all. I mean, is it houses, lands, and you know, cars and boats and motorhome? I mean, I don't know. I don't know what it is. But God says to you, it's either Achan